It's been real hard packed, so I think it's going to have a lot of good racing today.
What's long-term goals for Hangtown?
Well, I think, Jim, long-term goal, obviously, is to bring a GP into this part of the country. We have not had one here, to my memory, of 15-plus years of doing this. Very simply, that is the ultimate goal. The state would like to see us do it. The Dirt Diggers North would like to see us do it. And I think everybody's really got that as the bottom line that we're going for.
And the new track design here at Hangtown, you like it?
It's okay.
Just okay in what means? Like, how do you like the new start?
Well, they got such a big area to work with, and they don't use it. Seems like they don't really put that much effort into it.
What about the water conditioning? It looks like it's a little bit more better water, better prepared track.
Well, I'm sure they have to do that because they know if they don't do a decent job of preparing it, they won't have a race here any longer. So they're trying.
Not a whole lot of enthusiasm on the part of the defending national champ in the class. And look at why. Look, see that jersey? He went down in practice and just went end over end. And I don't think he was feeling too good at that point, Jim.
No, I don't think so, Larry. You know, he said the track really, they had to water it. And it looks like they watered it, according to his jersey.
Yeah, it looked like they watered it, and he got off his motorcycle and rolled in it. Now, coming up, another practice incident that was not without a little bit of humor. A guy over here tried to change teams. I think that's the way you described it. Tucked underneath that whole mess is a Suzuki rider, Spud Walters.
Yeah, I think he just, you know, Suzuki might not have been working that day, and he wanted to jump ship, and he asked the guy if he could borrow his Kawasaki.
His name is Myers. I want to quickly point out that there was absolutely no relation between the two of us, although I suspect if I were out there, that's the way I would ride.
I thought that was your brother, Larry.
Yeah, we do share similar traits, I guess, in riding styles. That's about that. No harm done. They pried the two apart. The guy says, thumbs up. Hey, let's go racing. Everybody's happy. No limping around. And we're not far from the start of the opening moto in this 250cc class at the Silver Anniversary here at Hangtown. It's coming up, as well as some 125cc action. Stay with us. When we come back, you'll see it on Cycle World.
At the top of the show, you may have noticed the wind was blowing, but now the wind has stopped. Temperatures well over 100 degrees. Earlier, we asked some of the riders what they feel about the heat, how they're getting acclimated to it.
Most of your preparation and stuff's done during the week when you're practicing and stuff, and where I practice, it's in the heat and stuff like that in Southern California, so a lot of the riders kind of get psyched out by the heat and everything, and I think the most important thing in between motos is drink plenty of water and kind of get maybe a banana or two inside you. And so that way you don't run out of energy during the second moto.
Well, where we've been riding out in California, it's been pretty warm. It's been real similar to this. And, you know, also back home, it's been real hot. But there we have the humidity. I just try to keep as much, keep as many fluids in my body as I can and rest as much throughout the day as I can and just be patient on the racetrack and use what you have to use at the right time.
Well, I particularly don't mind the heat. I enjoy the heat. I'm back in Michigan where it's hot and humid. And I always say the hotter the better because I enjoy the heat and the pressure going out there and being able to withstand it.
Well, those are some of the comments of today's riders. But I remember back when I used to ride, I always used to look for a lot of shade, used to drink plenty of fluids, and I never ever used the air conditioner in my rental car or hotel. That was the best way for me to get acclimated. I think it worked for me back then.
Well, just like yourself and the riders, the racetrack needs a gallon of water or two during the day to keep the dust down. That's what they're doing right there. They're dumping thousands and thousands of gallons on the track. It'll make for ideal race conditions a little bit later this afternoon. First, though, let's go back to Mount Morris, Pennsylvania, the previous event. It was there that Damon Bradshaw emerged as, well, not a championship contender. He has to prove that. But it did emerge as a front runner out here.
Well, I think he needed that win, him and Yamaha, because he floundered in the first two rounds, and he was able to rebound and win here in Mount Morris.
Yeah, floundered isn't the word. He finished fifth and ninth, and he was one of the preseason picks to take it all. But here at Mount Morris, Bradshaw really got it together. Now, Mike Kudrowski went on to take the win in moto number one, but the second moto, Damon Bradshaw rebounded and said, hey, guys, I'm showing you where it's at from now on. And he went on to capture the victory, leaving Kudrowski back in a number three position. Kudrowski ended up with second overall. Stanton did not do well at all at Mount Morris, as we earlier pointed out. He finished fourth overall on the day. There's Mike taking the checkered flag at the end of moto number one, and Bradshaw putting it in gear in the second moto. Let's hear from Damon Bradshaw.
Yeah, I'm real happy to, like I said this morning, I'm real happy to come back to Mount Morris and
It feels really good to ride in front of this crowd this morning. I didn't quite know if they were behind me like they normally would, but when I did that parade lap, man, those people really made me feel good, and I have to give that win to them. They did it for me. They cheered me along, and that's what kept me going.
Well, today, Damon Bradshaw will be facing a California crowd. Here's a look at the results from Bob Morris. Bradshaw with a 2-1 took the overall. Then it's Mike Kibrowski, Mike LaRocco, Jeff Stanton, and Guy Cooper rounding out the top five. Taking a look at the standings now, after three events, Mike Kibrowski on top with 142 points. He has two wins, the other win, of course, going to Damon Bradshaw. Jeff Stanton with no wins is in the number two position. That brings us up to date, the silver anniversary running of the Hangtown Classic. Here's a look at the race analysis. Last year's winner, Damon Bradshaw, will run two motos today. 30 minutes plus two laps. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Jim Holly, 97 degrees. It is hot, and it's not going to rain.
That's
going
to be a big factor, the heat, Larry. And all these guys, they have to put the fluids in prior to the event. They can't push them down the day of the race. They're just going to get stomach cramps.
Start extremely critical, and I would think with the heat situation being the way it is today, you want to run out front as early as you possibly can.
Well, you're absolutely right, Larry. Let's see who gets to start today.
Well, the gate has dropped, and the first moto at Hangtown is underway. And they pile up in the back part of the track. Let's move the camera over. There it is. Ray Somo and Lance Smale. Somo rider number 30, Smale number 36, getting together to talk things over. Meanwhile, Damon Bradshaw, just a little bit further on up the track, had his problems. He's going to start at the back of the pack. It's going to be tough to catch this guy, Mike Kibrowski, who's being chased by Buddy Antonez in third place, the local favorite from Pollock Pines, California, Team Honda's Steve Lampson. Right now, though, it's Kibrowski, the action on the track for the number two position.
Well, Kibrowski's out setting the pace right now. As you can see, the track's up and downhill. It's got a lot of grooves in it. They have to pick their lines. They want to make sure they get both wheels inside the grooves. They're just working on it. Kibrowski's setting a mean pace right now. He wants to try and break loose.
Well, continuing with that thought, Jim, the riders that are behind Kibrowski are going to do everything they can to stay with him, because if they get to battling amongst themselves, they're going to lose a little bit of ground, and Kibrowski, taking advantage of a clean track, is going to hustle his Kawasaki way out front. Then catching him in the later stages of a moto would be just about an impossibility. Now here comes Jeff Stanton. Right in front of him was Rick Ryan. Stanton has got his hands full. He's going to have to pass about five guys. He wants to get up there and contend for that number one spot.
Well, he's going to have to move, and he's going to have to move quick, because like you said, if Kibrowski gets out in front, he's gone. He has a clean, clear track to work with. Stanton's got to eat everybody's dust and worry about making other lines to pass.
Well, we'll find out if Stanton is able to get that job done, or if the pass can be made by Lampson when we come back. There's the way they stand. Stay with us on Cycle World.
In the beginning, TV networks like...
The coverage of the AMA National Championship Motocross Series on Cycle World. We're at Hangtown, Northern California, where we're watching round four of the championship series. Rider number seven on Team Suzuki's entry is Guy Cooper. Cooper, though not a factor in this one, but Cooper is one of the most enjoyable riders I think you'll ever see on a racetrack.
He's got to be the best rider to watch out for. He's just phenomenal the way he gets away with a lot of stuff on his bike.
Yeah, his forte really is jumping. We're not seeing a lot of that action. It'd be fun to see him in this section. That was Mike Kibrowski, who's running up front. Here's the battle for the number two position. Lampson makes the pass. He's been chasing Buddy Antonez for the past several laps. He finally got the job done, has taken over the number two slot. Now it is almost his backyard. He's from nearby Pollock Pines, California. The question is, can Lampson catch Kibrowski?
Well, it'll be interesting to see. You know, Lampson's coming off of a broken leg from last year. He won the event here in the 125 last year, so he's got plenty of experience here, Larry.
Yeah, that leg was a factor in the early going of the season, and it made a lot of folks wonder why Team Honda tapped him for a factory ride. So we put that question to Steve Lampson. Why?
I think a lot of it, 91 when I was riding on the Peak Pro Circuit team, I did a lot of testing with Dave Arnold and for the pre-production bikes, and I've in the past I've been really good at testing, so I think a lot of it was they wanted me on the team for a lot of testing, get the bikes good. I get along with all the guys really good, and basically just starting off in the 250s, supercross, I've done pretty good at some of them, so I think he figured that I'd get better and thought I had a lot of skill, and maybe a little bit of both, testing, and thought I'd be there right at the top too.
Bottom line is, Steve Lampson is a fine representative, and he really works hard to better himself on that motocross track. Right now, running in the number two position, Mike Kidrowski right in front of him. He's doing everything he possibly can to reel him in. Meanwhile, back in the pack, Stanton is emerging, and now he's challenging Buddy Antonez for the number three slot.
Yeah, Stanton's making a charge right now. He's there he goes right there for the pass on Antonez. Just flat out jumped him.
Yeah, he got the drive off that jump is what it looked like to me, and had just a little bit more power, a better line. We're going to go back and take another look at this in just a second, and you can point out where he got that power from. But now it's Jeff Stanton on the move as he's taking over the number three position, and he has Lampson, his teammate, and Kidrowski just a short straight away in front of him. In fact, you can see them right there doubling back. Jim, how'd he do it?
Well, what happened here, Antonez drifted up a little bit high, made a little bit of bobble, and I think Jeff capitalized on it and knew that he could drive off the jump a little bit. Here he just flat flies right past Antonez.
That's part of being a factory rider, knowing where your opponent is going to be and probably where you think he just might mess up. Jeff may have set that up a lap or two earlier. Now Guy Cooper is getting into the act. Guy Cooper, rider number seven. Antonez had dropped all the way back to fourth, and here comes Guy Cooper, and Cooper wants a piece of Antonez.
Yeah, I think, you know, like you said earlier in the show, Larry, Antonez is coming off an injury, and I think maybe he's just hasn't had the pace. You know, he's not used to running this pace for 35 minutes.
Yeah, well, he's better get used to it in a hurry, because Guy Cooper is breathing down his neck, and Guy Cooper, first season ever on a 250 machine. He's been primarily a 125 rider outdoors, and Cooper is in no mood to mess around. He has hinted, I say, at retirement. He refuses to say yes or no, but the hints kind of say probably this is his last season.
There you go.
Yeah. Cooper, there was no room there. I don't know where he found that
room. Well, I think he made the room. He just flat moved Antonez out of his way and said, I'm going to the front, and you can work your way back.
Cooper has hinted that it might be his last year. He didn't want to make it official because he didn't want people to feel sorry for him, and he didn't want people to think that, hey, he's got to win out here now, and he felt that if he made that announcement, then he might even slack off. So he's left the door open. He says, maybe I'll come back next year, maybe I won't. Meanwhile, behind Guy Cooper, in fact, behind Buddy Antonez, a battle raging as Mike LaRocco has come from out of the pack. Yeah, he had a terrible start. Now he's challenging for sixth place. That's currently held by Brian Manley.
Well, that's his trademark. He always seems to get bad starts here in the Nationals.
Oh, well, there he goes. Yeah. He picked off one more. He made a good move there on Manley. He takes over the number, that would be the number six position, dropping Manley back to seventh. LaRocco is really on the gas, and you pointed it out. He's done that throughout his career.
Yeah, he's got to make moves. Anytime you get a bad start like this in Nationals, you only have 30 minutes to work up. If you come up on a rider, right when you come up to him, you have to pass him and move on. You have to concentrate on moving to the front. That's what LaRocco's doing right now. He's riding aggressive.
Yeah, I would think that by moving that quickly, the rider does not have time to set up, does not have time to block you, whereas if you continue to follow him, he knows you're back there, and he's going to stay in front of you. So the front-running positions are set for the drag race to the finish. LaRocco is in sixth. Kidrowski out front. Stay with us. We'll see how it comes out on Cycle World. Dunlop, we're watching the battle for the number five position. It's Buddy Antonez on the red motorcycle, a Honda, and here comes Mike LaRocco, who has cut a wide swath through this pack to take over the number five position. He's passed Antonez, and now he'll go toward the front, where, coincidentally, his teammate is leading this race. That would be Mike Kidrowski, and I think, Jim, you'll agree that teammates are the toughest guys to get along with on a track.
Well, I think Mike LaRocco needs to ask Kidrowski how to get starts, because if he got a start, he'd be up there battling with Kidrowski.
That's a good point. LaRocco's never known for getting a good start. Always has to come from out of the pack. Earlier, we asked him about his teammate.
Well, I think we have a pretty good relationship. The people at Kawasaki, you know, they make us all feel the same. So it's not that we're going out there racing each other. We're going out doing the same thing, you know, for Kawasaki and racing everybody else. If it comes down to, you know, we are racing each other, that's, you know, it's on the track. You know, we're doing our jobs is to race and to win. So it's, I think with me and Mike, things are real good.
Well, there's another pair of teammates, Jim, that in just a few more corners are not going to get along well at all. Jeff Stanton trying to put the moves on Steve Lampson, and he did. He got the drive off that jump, took over the number two position. So now the defending champ is out front with his teammate Steve Lampson doing the chasing. And Lampson's not going to like that at all. And Lampson, I think, will work awfully hard to try to rebound. I don't think he wants to settle for that number three position.
Well, it's interesting. Stanton also passed Antonis in that same spot. I think Jeff likes that jump. He's real aggressive off of it. And it's been working for him. That's where he's been making his passes at.
Can Lampson come back? That's the question.
Well, you know, I think he can. It's a matter, I think we want to study his lines to see exactly where Jeff's going. There he looked over. He's looking to see how far the other guy is behind him. So I think he's just going to lay back, study his lines, and then try to make a pass later in the race.
Let's go back and take another look at that pass that Jeff Stanton put on his teammate Steve Lampson to take over the number two position.
Well, here it comes up here. It's the same thing as Antonis. Lampson drifts a little wide. Jeff squares up underneath him and just drives a lot harder off the jump. He's just jumping way far. Steve actually is going to move over on him. I think he sees that it's Jeff and kind of decides not to do it. Maybe he's going to square up underneath him right here, but he didn't quite get a good enough drive off the corner.
Yeah, that's a good point. There we're talking about teammates giving way just a little bit to teammates. Meanwhile, Mike Rolocco continues his charge. He has just passed Guy Cooper, rider number 7 on the Suzuki, just passed Cooper to take over the number 4 position. Now, Cooper, he gave way reluctantly, and it held Rolocco's charge up considerably. Meanwhile, the guys out front, Jim, were streaking away from them. The question would be, Rolocco moving as fast as he is obviously going, does he have time to catch them?
Rolocco's definitely moving up fast, and he does definitely have enough time to do it. You know, you have 35 minutes out here to work, and I think Rolocco's the fastest fan on the track right now.
I think so, too. He's got that momentum going in his favor, and now he's pulling Cooper along with him. When he made the pass, Cooper picked up the pace. Had they been running at that pace while Cooper was holding him off, then they would have been up there already. But when you start blocking a guy, when you start worried about getting past, then you're going to slow down just a little bit. That's not Cooper's normal style, but it is a normal tendency to do that.
Well, here we got another battle, Larry, for the sixth place between Larry Brooks and John Dowd. It's interesting to see Dowd work his way up from a bad start. You know, he won here 2 years ago.
Yes, he did. In completely different circumstances. You recall the track was underwater. Seems like we went through a monsoon. In fact, they only ran one moto.
Larry Brooks goes down.
So Dowd inherited one more position, and he didn't have to work very hard to get it. Brooks cooperated by just sliding out. He's back up. He's running again. No harm done. He did drop a place in the standings there, but fortunately he got back up. Here it is again. What did he do?
Well, he's out of shape here going into the turn right here, and it just looks like he might be a little tired. Just the front end just washed right out from underneath him.
Yeah, it looked like he got it back under control and was going to make that corner all right, but he ran up into that soft stuff, buried the front wheel. I don't know, maybe he grabbed a handful of brake when he shouldn't have.
Or maybe he just lost a little concentration, Larry.
Well, that's a distinct possibility. Larry Brooks has crashed a time or two in his career. Always rebounds, though. Here's a guy that has not rebounded at all well today. He has started the moto with a crash in the first corner. He's up to the number 20 position, but, boy, that's not where he should be. He should be up inside the top 10. He's had ample time to get there. Well, look at that. Look at that. He's just not riding well at all. He's stumbling in the middle of the pack, and Damon Bradshaw, one of the best riders in the world, is just not putting it together. As a matter of fact, he's about to get lapped. The guys are coming up behind him, and they're going to lap him if he does not pick up the pace, and that would be an embarrassment to Damon Bradshaw.
Well, I think an embarrassment.
There's the blue flag right there. See the guys telling him, move over. The guys are coming up behind you. Don't get in their way. If I'm Bradshaw, I'm embarrassed. And look, Dag Boysen says, well, we'll move over after I go ahead and get around you. And he took advantage of Bradshaw moving out of the way to make the pass. Meanwhile, up front, here come the Chargers, third place, Pollock Pines, California, Team Honda, Steve Lampson, and the crowd is behind this guy here today.
In defense of Damon Bradshaw, Larry, you know, we don't know if his bike's broken or maybe Damon's hurt himself.
Well, that's a good point. I guess I was a little bit harsh on him there. Meanwhile, at the front of the pack, Mike Kidrowski is taking the white flag. He'll have one more lap to go. Here it is, white flag waving, and boy, he's happy to be seeing that. And I still have to think that Bradshaw's going to be happy to see it, too, because if the bike is not working, if he's not working right, whatever it might be, he'll want to get this moto over. Kudrowski has had it his way. Took the lead at the opening gun. The man, he has done nothing but put distance between himself and the rest of the pack. Behind him, he's being chased by the defending champ. And look, Kudrowski waving at the crowd. He's pumped. But he's being chased by the defending champion, Jeff Stanton, who charged from out of the pack. He's the guy that really I thought this series would belong to. Not turning out that way. Here comes Steve Lampson. Look at him. Boy, he's happy, isn't he?
Yeah, it's got to be a hometown favorite here, finishing third like this, coming off of a broken leg last year. It's a great performance for Steve. It's his best finish this year on the National.
Yeah, you did. We started talking about that crowd being behind him all over the track. They're hollering. They're shaking their hands at him. They're waving their shirts that are off in this hot temperature. And Lampson has responded. He's turned in a great ride. He won this event on a 125cc, and who knows? It could turn out that today he'll win it on a 250cc. So we'll just wait and see how this one turns out, the second moto. Kudrowski obviously going to win this one walking away. He slowed the pace now. He's circulating around the racetrack. He acknowledges the crowd every once in a while. Most of them, as I said, are starting to chant for Steve Lampson, who's finishing third. There was the checkered flag. Mike Kudrowski brings it home, the winner. And take a look at the finishing results. It's Kudrowski, Stanton, Lampson, LaRocco, and Guy Cooper in that order. Meanwhile, my partner in crime here, Jim Holley, a former racer himself and has been in that victory circle, is now going to go down, or is already there, I should say, to visit with Mike Kudrowski. Let's hear what they have to say.
Great ride, Mike. By our count, it was about a 15-second lead. How'd you do it?
Well, I just got a good start. I was just waiting for that hole shot, and I got it, and just kind of rode my own race. I knew Lampson was back there. I knew he was fast in practice, and just kind of rode my own race and, you know, concentrate on being smooth and not sliding out and stuff, and I think that's what paid off.
You're really not sweating that hard. You must have got acclimated at heat. How was the heat out there?
It wasn't really that bad. I thought it'd be worse, but, it just went easy, and when you ride like that, you're out in front, and it's easy, so you don't sweat as much.
Great ride. Good luck, second moto.
Thanks a lot.
A lot of action yet to come, including the second moto in this 250 class. When we come back, we'll take a look at the 125. Stay with us.
Traditionally, the 125 class is used as a stepping stone towards the 250 and 500 class. Ironically, here today, competing in Hangtown, we already have a world champion entered. South Lake Tahoe's Sean Palmer is making his debut today at Hangtown. However, at the tender age of 24, Sean is already a four-time world champion in the sport of snowboarding.
You're trying to promote O'Neill.
Sean Palmer, world champion snowboarder. What brings you out here today?
To race motocross in the off-season. I'm racing 125 Pro class when I'm not boarding out there in the glaciers in the wintertime.
Tell me the difference between, like, snowboarding and racing a motorcycle. What's the difference?
There's a lot of difference, actually. The temperature sure is hot out here today. Usually it's all snowy, and snowboarding, you're kind of riding sideways like that. Out here on the motocross bike, you're kind of getting it all on. You know, it's getting a little crazy out here, and I'm going to try to make the main today, Jimmy.
Sounds good.
The temperature's a lot different. Snow and dirt's a lot, and the temperature. There's a lot of difference, Jim. Snow and dirt's a hell of a lot of difference, and I'm out here to cut.
I had to nudge that thing. You knew that.
Yeah. National Championship Motocross Series. We're at Hangtown in Sacramento, California. The crowd is set, and so are we, for 125cc action. But first, let's go back to Mount Morris, Pennsylvania. It was the previous race in this 125 class. Let's see how they shook them out. The focal point at Mount Morris was rider number 593, at least in the early going. That's Robbie Rayner. Not because he was leading the series, Jim, but because he is probably the most heralded rookie rider to come along in years. He just signed a brand new factory contract for a whole bunch of bucks.
I wish I got that kind of money when I was a rookie.
I bet you wish you could have that kind of money right now, or maybe in the best season that you ever had. In any event, he took a lesson today from the pros, or that day, I should say, in particular, the defending 125 national champ. That was Jeff Emig out front, and the guy that made a lot of noise coming from out of the pack, number 16, Doug Henry. Henry is the series leader. He's gone fast all season long. Rayner did not do all that bad. He finished 7th and 8th in the pair of motos for 7th overall. I think for your initial outing, that is pretty good.
I think it's got to be great, you know, 7th overall for his first national, first pro race, for that matter. It's a great job.
A year or so down the line, and he'll take the checkered flag. Let's go to Jeff Emig in winner's circle.
Yeah, be happy. Well, both motos is definitely the way to win it. And from a start to finish, both motos, you know, I couldn't ask for any more. You know, there at the end, I'm kind of telling myself, you know, you've done this before, you know, let's just keep calm, you know, and do this again.
Well, you really made a statement today, haven't you?
Oh, yeah, you know, like that's what I'm going to try. You know, the year has been so for me, but I'm here to show the last champion's back, and he wants it again.
Well, I think you call that kind of confidence a champ attack. We'll find out. There are 12 races in this 125cc series. A long way to go. Here are the results from Mount Morris. Emig, Henry, McGrath, Ryan Hughes, and Eric Kehoe rounding out the top five. Take a look at the standings after three rounds, three different winners. It's Doug Henry on top, followed by McGrath, Emig, Kehoe, and Ezra Lusk. And that sets the stage for round four of the 125cc Championship Series here at Hangtown. We'll take a look at what went on, the action a little bit earlier today. At the front of the pack, it was Ezra Lusk. At the back of the pack, a rider that you know very well, Jim, used to race against him.
Yeah, that's right. Johnny O'Meara is caught underneath Jimmy Gaddis' bike there. Brian Ross trying to get up. It's unfortunate for Johnny. You know, he's trying to make a comeback.
Well, he'll have ample time to make a comeback today as he'll be at the tail end of the racetrack. Meanwhile, up front, it's Ezra Lusk. Lusk is good at getting hole shots. Lusk is good at losing his concentration. And a little bit later in this moto, you'll see exactly what I mean and what will happen to him. Remember our champ, the bold, brave words? There he is, running in the number two position. So he's making his prediction come through. Jeremy McGrath holding down the number three slot. This is the early going of moto number one. Now watch this. Watch Lusk as he comes around the corner. Wham! He ran into a pole that supports the fence and went down. Jim, it's not only painful, but it's a good way to cut your racing career short.
Well, I've done that a few times. I don't know, you just lose a little concentration, you dive a little bit inside, you might have been excited leading the thing, and the pole just caught the front brake and locked the front wheel on, as we can see coming up to it on the replay. You know, he's riding good, he's out front, riding aggressive, just looks to dive to the inside a little bit too much, bam, the pole catches the front brake, tucks the front end underneath, and as you said, Larry, lucky he didn't bust his wrist.
Well, I've seen Ezra Lusk do that so many times this year. He had best straightened that part of his riding out, and frankly, I think he will. So Ezra Lusk is having some bad luck at the other end of the spectrum, though. Having a good time of it out here today, rider number 100 is James Dobb. He's chasing Eric Kehoe, number 22. He'll put the move on Kehoe, and Dobb is doing well. He's an English rider, Jim. Came over to this country to make his mark, and as he made that pass, I think he's also made that mark.
But he's doing really well. He's coming off of a wrist injury. He was out the first 5 months of the season here, and he's got the wrist in working order.
Well, I think what he has in working order is that Kawasaki and this racetrack. Meanwhile, up front, Jeremy McGrath continues to chase Jeff Emig, the number one rider in this particular contest and the number one rider in the 125 class. I can tell you right now, I've read the book. McGrath is going to come up short. Jeff Emig is going to go on and win moto number one with McGrath in tow. Now, McGrath has bet everything indoors this season. Outdoors, he's been kind of hot and cold.
Well, you're right, Larry. He hasn't really adapted to the outdoor tracks yet. Here we see Doug Henry coming up on Eric Kehoe. And Doug had a bad start. He's working his way. There he goes, right past Eric Kehoe here. Doug's leading the points right now. He needs to pass a lot of guys and get up towards the front with Emig and McGrath.
Well, that pass that you just saw on Eric Kehoe is the reason that Doug Henry is leading the points. He has turned into a dynamite 125cc rider. So that pass that Henry just made was for third place. Meanwhile, up front, taking the checkered flag, Jeff Emig. He makes it three motos in a row. Can he come back and do it one more time? That was his prediction. Let's see what happens in moto number two. Emig got the hole shot. He was out front again, the rear of the pack. A little bit of a problem there. Everyone's picking himself up. They're going to get themselves going. No problem at all. But watch what happens to Jeff Emig. Look at that. He was all by himself, went around the corner. I think he had visions of checkered flag in his mind, Jim, and he just got a little bit ahead of himself.
Well, I don't know if he had visions of the checkered flag. I think that they watered the track there a little bit, and it was kind of a little slippery there because the front end just flat washed right out from underneath him.
Meanwhile, James Dobb, the English rider, takes over the number one position. He's being chased by Doug Henry's teammate. That's Jeremy McGrath, the man that's done it all indoors, the guy we said had been spotty outdoors. He's won a couple of events this year, and he's going to go on and make the pass on Dobb here. But James Dobb is doing a very creditable job holding down that number one position with a lot of pressure behind him.
Pressure's the right word, Larry. He's got about 39 guys that won his spot. Here we're going to take a look at the replay. Emig just goes into the first turn. Front end just washes right out from underneath him.
And bang, down he goes, and that's only the start of his problems. Watch this. He tries to get the motorcycle up, the bike is hit, and several riders decide to occupy that airspace that Jeff Emig owned. Watch him now. He's just going to, oh, no, he says. He puts his hands up to his helmet. Actually, he was just adjusting his goggles, but it looked like he was giving up the ship. But give up, he did not do. He got a swap through this pack, Jim, let's call it a championship swap. Ended up passing 33 riders to finish in the number seven position. I want to tell you, that's some kind of ride.
Well, that's the mark of a true champion, never to give up and always give it the amount of points that you can. And it's a great ride for Emig to work up to seventh position, Larry.
So while Emig was passing everyone in sight, Jeremy McGrath had absolutely no one to pass. He just kind of rolled home the winner in moto number two. Let's go to the overall winner of the day, Jeremy McGrath, see what he had to say.
Jeremy, great ride. 2-1, get through the overall day. Tell us, what did you do different between the motos?
Well, I just tried to ride the moto same as I did the first time. I think I lasted a little bit longer than that time. I think the heat got to me a little bit more in the first moto, and I think I didn't let it get to me that time.
How's the track holding up? The new design, they're getting enough water for you guys?
Track is okay. It's a little bit one line, but, hey, first year with a new track and stuff, I'm looking forward to coming racing next year.
Great ride, Jeremy. That makes two wins for you this year on the championship. Think you can get it back?
Well, we'll see. It's a long haul, but I'm trying my hardest.
Thanks, Jeremy.
Thanks.
Great future ahead for that young man. Here's the way they finished at Hancock in the 125 class. McGrath took the overall with a second and a first in the two motos. Then came Doug Henry, Jeff Emig, James Dobb, and on down the line. Here are the standings now. Henry's still out in front, although he has only won one event. McGrath has won two. Henry has a 20-point lead in this championship chase in the 125cc class. There is still a lot of action remaining here at the Hangtown Classic. The second moto in the 250cc class is coming up. It's going to be a barn burner. Stay tuned to Prime Network and Cycle World. To you, the silver anniversary running of the Hangtown Motocross Classic. This is the second moto in the 250cc class. Out front, once again, Mike Kudrowski with a hole shot. Oh, and some action in the back of the pack. Guy on the left wanted to go right, there was someone his way.
Yeah, they just clipped each other. You're right, though, Larry. Well, there's Mike Kudrowski out front. He's setting an early pace again.
Well, he is, but he's got some company up front. It should be good. There's Steve Lampson close to the front. Jeff Stanton was running third. Running back in the pack one more time is Damon Bradshaw. Bradshaw is not riding well at all today. You have to wonder if that first corner crash in the opening moto maybe took its toll on Damon Bradshaw. There's Stanton working around the edge of the track, the outer edge of the track. Right up behind Lampson, in front of him is Ricky Ryan is up there in between Kudrowski and the rest of the pack.
And also Buddy Antonez, their old buddies up there.
Buddy Antonez did a good job in moto number one. Unfortunately, he only did a good job for about 10 minutes. Then he went backwards. There's Antonez, rider number 32. Antonez, in fairness to him, out of condition. We saw Mike LaRocco, rider number 5. He's going to have to work his way through the pack one more time. But that's LaRocco's trademark, as we discussed. But out front with a clear track, this is where he wants to put him away, is Mike Kudrowski.
Well, I think he's really trying to study the track here, Larry, because there has been a couple races since they've been out on the track. And, wow, as you can see, it's really dusty out there in the second moto.
Indeed it is. None of that dust bothering Mike Jedrowski, though, as he holds down the number one position, followed by Steve Lampson. Then comes Buddy Antonez. Jeff Stanton making a move now, has moved to the rear wheel of Antonez. And, of course, running through Stanton's mind is not only getting out of that dust, but getting around Antonez so that he can, try to run down the leaders.
Absolutely. Every second he spins behind Antonez here, it just makes it easier for Jedrowski and Lampson to pull away from him.
Jim, as a professional motocrosser, I'll bow to your expertise because I know that you have been in every one of those positions. So the question is, will Jeff Stanton pass Antonez? Can he catch Lampson and Jedrowski? We'll find out when we come back to the Hangtown Classic. Position changes. Stanton and Cooper getting by Buddy Antonez. Actually, Antonez getting back by Cooper, but here comes Cooper one more time. Draws alongside Antonez, and again he makes the pass. Now that graphic would be correct if we put it back up on the board. So Mike Jedrowski out front. We're looking at a battle back in the pack, a three-way battle, because here comes Mike LaRocco to jump into it. Head and tail, wheels, handlebars, helmet, gloves, everything he's got. He's come from out of the pack, and Holly, another patented charge.
You got to hand it to him, you know. He just knows how to knife through all these riders here, you know. Here he's just riding really back and forth with Antonez. He's just fighting. There he goes for the pass right there, Larry.
Yeah, back and forth, my eye. He just went to fourth. That's all he did, and Buddy Antonez went back. That's LaRocco's trademark. We've said it two, three times today, and now he sets his sights toward the front of the pack, where we have a battle between Steve Lampson. This is round number two of that one. They went at it in moto number one, with Stanton coming out on top, and Jeff Stanton, who is rider number one. Those are the two riders involved. Let's go back and take a look at the pass that Mike LaRocco put on Antonez.
Well, here it is, Larry. LaRocco just drives the outside, squares up underneath. Antonez gets a little bit of wheel spin here. LaRocco's got the drive on the approach to the jump, just out jumps Antonez and just makes a good clean pass. That's the kind of pass you want to make.
Well, LaRocco has had plenty of practice as in both motos today. He has come from out of the pack to put himself in contention for a win. It's Mike Jedrowski way out front, but this is where the action is, the battle for the number two position. The teammates for Team Honda and Lansom bottles just a little bit. Stanton had an opportunity there, but they didn't take advantage of it. He's running in third, the defending champ. Now, here's the thing. As Stanton drives, he got a good drive, so maybe he was able. Maybe he did take advantage of that bobble by getting the wheel down and really uncorking that one, because he went by him like he was standing still.
I promise you, he's not standing still, and he's not going to give up. I think this race is going to go down to the end.
Here's another one that might go to the end. Guy Cooper is in fourth place. Here comes our old friend Mike LaRocco. Again, I point out to those of you that are listening, not to be redundant, but Mike LaRocco has come from a long ways in the pack to move into a position to challenge the front runners. He's just done a great job, and it's up to Cooper now to hold him off if he can. Cooper, though, has a tendency to ride his own race, and he's going to leave a door or two open for LaRocco.
Well, I think if he leaves the door open, I think LaRocco's just going to come out and take it and just rip past him like he was standing still.
Here he goes. Here he goes. You no sooner made the call, and he did it. Now, Cooper, I thought he was going to get a wheel on the inside there and maybe try to rebound, but there was nowhere to go. Meanwhile, up front, it's still hammer and tong, and here comes Lampson right back. He's got the good line on Stanton, and no, I thought he had a chance there to make that pass. Look, he's coming back again. This is an unbelievable battle between a couple of Honda riders. This time, Lampson made it stick. Now, I am surprised, because Stanton was in contention for the title, and I really would have thought that Honda would have said, look, Steve, you stay behind Stanton. You know, Jim, maybe the hints were thrown at Lampson, and he just didn't catch them. We'll find out when we come back to wrap up this second moto from Hangtown. Winding down at the Hangtown Classic. This is the final moto in the 250cc class. You're watching Jeff Stanton, who is in third. Mike LaRocco riding his rear wheel in fourth. He came from out of nowhere, and now he's trying to get the wheel on the inside to make the pass. There goes LaRocco with a good drive, and he takes over. LaRocco is now in the number three position. That'll drop Stanton back to fourth. Now ahead of LaRocco, we have Steve Lampson. He's in second, and our leader since the outset of this one is Mike Jedrowski. Here's Lampson running in the number two position. Lamson is going to run home today with a second overall, and that is not too shabby. The people here at Hangtown, look at there. Look at him pump that fist. Look at him clap. They love him. He's from nearby Pollock Pines, California, and they love Steve Lamson here. Meanwhile, Mike Kidrowski is headed for the checkered flag. He's on his final lap, and Jim Holly has headed down to Victory Circle to join Kidrowski. There's Kidrowski waving at the crowd. I guarantee you, though, he's not getting the reception that Steve Lamson. Actually, you know what? Maybe he was not waving at the crowd. Maybe he was waving at Bradshaw. He just lapped Damon Bradshaw for the second time today. I got to tell you, folks, I think there is something wrong with Bradshaw, because he is much faster than he has exhibited out here today. So Mike Kidrowski makes it a double. He wins both motos to handily take the overall win for the day. That'll make it his third of the year, if I'm not mistaken. Lamson comes home in the number two position, followed by Stanton, Mike LaRocco, and John Dowd. Did not see a lot of Dowd today. A good finish for that young man. He is the top privateer in the standings right now. In fact, Dowd has climbed to the number three position. Mike Kidrowski is on top. Stanton in second, then Dowd, Lamson, and LaRocco. Kidrowski with three wins, 192 points, is threatening to run away with this thing. Bradshaw has dropped out of the top five. Let's go to Jim Holly, who is with our winner, Mike Kidrowski.
Tell some of the people out there how you've been getting these good starts, because, you know, you weren't noted for getting these good starts, and you're pulling two whole shots, and you're just walking away from everybody. 25-second lead, just flat-footed to the boys today. Well, we've been working on our bike a lot, you know, through the Supercrosses and stuff, and I think we got our bikes running a little bit better for the Nationals, the way I like to have them run, and I think that's what's helping me on my starts, and we've been working a lot with suspension, so my Kawasaki's running great right now. I don't think I'm going to switch nothing for the rest of the 250 Nationals.
I don't think I would either. I think you got the winning combination. Great job today, Mike.
Thanks a lot.
Well, despite Mike Kidrowski leading the point standings, Kawasaki is only in the number two position in the manufacturer's standings. Now, what you're looking at are the combined points earned by the various manufacturers from the 125 and 250 class finishes. Jim Holly has rejoined me in the booth. Jim, any final thoughts?
Well, I think Mike's done his homework. You know, he's getting the starts that he needs. He prepared for the heat today. His mechanics set up the bike perfectly. I think they're on the way for a championship.
I think so, too. And that'll give him a 125, a 250, and a 500 crown. In fact, two 125 crowns. While on location, cast and crew stay at the Comfort Inn.